tonight, a noose is found at a downtown construction site. The construction company and police are investigating, and it's not the first time this has happened on a Toronto job site. Plus,
as far as I'm concerned, they got away with it.
They didn't walk today. That's not what happened.
Split opinions as an off-duty Toronto police officer is found guilty of assault in the beating of DeFonte Miller, but cleared of more serious charges. And
I do believe in public services, but I don't think that that should come at the cost of my coworkers and myself.
Some lifeguards are concerned about a lack of training as public pools start to reopen. Good evening, I'm Mike Wise. Toronto police are investigating after some construction workers found a noose hanging at a downtown construction site yesterday. It's actually the second time this month this has happened at a building under construction. Angelina King has the latest.
The noose was found at this construction site behind me yesterday. It's on Bay Street, just across the street from the Scotiabank Arena. Police say that it was found about 50 stories up, and you can see that in this photo sent to CBC Toronto. Police say that workers found it when they were installing the HVAC system, and that the same type of rope used is used to suspend HVAC systems. Police say at this point it's not being investigated as a hate crime. Now, the Urban Alliance on Race Relations says the whole incident is just sad, and that nobody should feel unsafe in their workplace because of the color of their skin.
You know, to have someone who is going to put a noose with a clear message of "you do not belong," it's just, as I said, it's very disheartening and hurtful.
Ellis Dawn and Govan Brown are managing the project and say that they've launched their own investigation. Ellis Dawn says its supervisors invoked an emergency stand down, meaning that work is paused so the supervisors could condemn what took place and demand whoever put the noose up to come clean. The company also says it's offering assistance to anyone who needs support. In a statement, the company's CEO and president called the act disgraceful and cowardly and called those behind it, quote, deviant morons. The statement also went on to say, "We will do everything to identify, prosecute, and evict anyone involved from the industry. They acted in a way to achieve notoriety by sowing hatred, but we'll never let that happen." The president of Govan Brown also strongly condemning the act, saying in part, "I cannot stress enough that we will do everything possible to ensure those responsible are held accountable." This happened earlier this month at another construction site in Toronto, also run by Ellis Dawn. On June 10th, two nooses were found hanging from construction equipment at Michael Garron Hospital in an area not accessible to the public. Police say that incident is being investigated as a hate crime, and right now they are looking into whether the two are linked. Angelina King, CBC News, Toronto.
A judge found an off-duty Toronto police officer guilty of assault today in the beating of DeFonte Miller. An attack so serious the young man lost an eye. That same judge cleared Constable Michael Theriault of much more serious charges. Theriault's brother, Christian, was also cleared on all charges today. Today's verdicts were delivered online and watched by thousands of people. Lorenda Redekop has the reaction.
A legal judgment streamed over YouTube because of the pandemic. Justice Joseph DeLuca found Toronto Police Officer Michael Theriault guilty of assault, not the more serious charge he faced, aggravated assault, and not guilty of attempting to obstruct justice by misleading police. His brother Christian Theriault, not guilty on both counts. The judge said DeFonte Miller and his friends likely were breaking into vehicles that night, as the Theriault brothers said, but he didn't accept the brothers' account that they chased Miller in order to arrest him. And the judge said if DeFonte Miller was wielding a pipe at one point, it was brief, and he was overpowered and beaten on by two men, the trail of blood showing what happened. The judge said Miller's blood at the end of the pipe indicates Michael Theriault used it, not just his fists. Justice DeLuca accepted a medical expert's testimony that Miller likely lost his eye due to a punch. He acknowledged the role of race, saying one could well ask how this matter might have unfolded if the first responders arrived at a call late one winter evening and observed a black man dressed in socks with no shoes, claiming to be a police officer, asking for handcuffs while kneeling on top of a significantly injured white man.
We've come a long way, you know, because I remember the night when this happened to me, I ended up getting charged, you know, and now we're in a situation where an officer has been held accountable to some extent.
His lawyer wants a federal inquiry on black, indigenous, and racialized people in police custody.
This is not an isolated incident. This is not about one bad apple. This is happening across North America. Not because all police are bad, but because the ongoing victimization of racialized and indigenous people.
But outside the court, where Miller's supporters gathered, frustration.
Today was a huge miscarriage for justice. Today, our court failed black people.
Michael Theriault is still a Toronto police officer. He's suspended with pay. His next court appearance is July 15th. The maximum conviction for assault is 5 years in prison. For aggravated assault, he could have faced up to 10 years. Lorenda Redicott, CBC News, Toronto.
As Lorenda mentioned, Michael Theriault is a Toronto police officer. Now, following the verdict, his boss, Mark Saunders, spoke to the media.
As chief, I can't deny that this matter will have an increased strain on a relationship between the police and the community, specifically the black community, especially those who have lived experiences of discrimination in the justice system or by the police. I speak to those today when I appeal to you to take this decision to voice your concerns, your experiences, and your desire for change in a peaceful and constructive way. We know that public trust is everything, and we as an organization will do absolutely everything we can to ensure that we have the public's trust.
Saunders said the police service will continue its own investigation into Michael Theriault, who remains suspended. He wouldn't comment on when or whether Theriault will return to work. Now, detectives have identified the man stabbed to death in St. Jamestown late last night.
We are also appealing to witnesses who may have been in the area, who may have cell phone camera and may have filmed what had transpired.
The victim is 30-year-old Stefan Anton Knights Roberts. Now, this happened just before 11:30 last night near Wellesley and Ontario Street. Police say when officers showed up, they found the man bleeding from his stab wounds. His death marks the 34th murder in the city this year. Investigators say there was a loud dispute in the moments leading up to the stabbing. A crowd of tents is growing outside of Toronto City Hall as protesters occupy Nathan Phillips Square for the seventh day in a row. The peaceful protest, led by Community Collective Afro-Indigenous Rising, has been going on since last Friday. The organization's demands include a city plan to diminish anti-black racism and police brutality and to put a stop to the violence against Indigenous communities. Organizers are calling on people to join their sit-in. They're also looking for donations of food, water, tents, and PPE through a GoFundMe page. The organization has raised about $40,000 to support the protest. Any additional funds, they say, will go to community initiatives such as bail funds and rent relief. A nail salon in Kingston is dealing with a COVID-19 outbreak, prompting that city's mayor to make face masks mandatory in all indoor public settings. Now, since reopening 2 weeks ago, health officials have linked 18 cases of the coronavirus to the salon, with as many as 700 people potentially exposed. Kingston's mayor says the salon had not been following protocols.
Just in terms of cleaning and how many people can be in the waiting room, the physical distancing. I think there were a few concerns, and probably the biggest one is that there were some employees that were coming to work even though they had symptoms.
Now, Kingston, which had been controlling the disease, has seen a spike in testing since the outbreak, with long lines outside assessment centers today. Well, tomorrow, more than 50 pools around the city will be officially opened as part of Stage 2, but some lifeguards are concerned they're not yet equipped to keep themselves and the public safe. Kel DeYoon has that story.
This pool at Heron Park Community Center has officially reopened.
The bottom line is the pools are open thanks to the heroic work of our parks, forestry and recreation team.
As with all pools, capacity will be reduced to 25%, and everyone is required to sign in and answer some questions first. Swim time will also be limited, but not everyone is thrilled.
I was shocked. I thought that there was no way they were going to open the pools because we're during a pandemic and there is no way that we could eliminate contact.
This Toronto lifeguard we spoke to didn't want to be identified for fear of losing her job, but she is very concerned about going back to work. She works at an indoor pool set to reopen on July 6. For lifeguards, the city says non-contact rescue should be used if possible. They are also required to put on extra protection.
First lifeguard to jump in would go and get the person to the side, and then while that is happening, another lifeguard's supposed to get into full gear, which they said is mask and gown, which we have never been trained to put on or anything like that.
In fact, she says she never saw the HEPA filters, an important layer of protection that she was told lifeguards would be given and which the city has recommended lifeguards put on in case of resuscitation.
There are different procedures for using the HEPA mask. From what I understand, a seal must be maintained throughout the entire rescue, which is something that should be practiced.
Mayor John Tory this afternoon says he understands the concerns but believes it's safe.
I think what you're hearing is more a sense of uncertainty and anxiety about that, which is understandable. And I would just say that certainly it would be my wish, and I know that Janie and her team would concur in this, that if anybody is feeling anxious and they don't feel the training they've had so far has made them comfortable with the procedures that have to be followed in the wake of COVID-19, they should ask for more training.
I do believe in public services, but I don't think that that should come at the cost of my coworkers and myself.
She was not the only lifeguard that we spoke to. We spoke to a few others as well, and they too tell us that they have concerns over the lack of training or lack of proper training. They say their training lasted about 2.5 hours and they never got to use this new equipment, particularly this HEPA filter that you're supposed to use in an emergency scenario where someone needs to be resuscitated. So they too tell us that they don't feel prepared to go back to work. Calder Union, CBC News, Toronto.
Also starting up tomorrow, public ferry service to the Toronto Islands. You'll need to buy your ticket in advance, and the city is limiting the number of visitors. Our Taylor Simmons looks at how island residents are reacting to the news.
Step right up, 6 feet at a time. The island ferries are back in business tomorrow.
I think we're all looking forward to having the island open. I wouldn't say all. I think most of us are looking forward to people coming.
If you're in the garden gardening and, people stop and you get in conversations, and I've missed that.
But there are some concerns in the community the virus could spread. Due to the island's small population, Toronto Public Health couldn't confirm whether the islands have seen any cases for privacy reasons.
I think many residents are concerned about the influx of people coming. We do have a number of people in the community who are vulnerable in terms of their health.
Others like Ian Rankin think of these packed gates from summers past.
When the crowds arrive, it's just going to be chaos. There's a lot of people who don't social distance and they don't use the masks, and they're there to have fun.
Rankin takes the ferry to and from the island for work and wonders how islanders will be able to travel safely and efficiently.
So our concern is that we won't be able to access our homes in a reasonable fashion.
The city is taking precautions to make the trip across safe. Tickets must be bought online, ferries will run at 50% capacity, and masks must be worn by passengers at all times.
Today, Mayor John Tory said they'll also have extra staff on hand to ensure guests are following the new requirements.
So I hope that all of that good management and good preparation will lead to a situation where there's lots of people who use the ferries, but it's within the limits, obviously, and also well organized, as I'm sure it will be.
So far, the city says about 1,500 people have bought tickets for tomorrow's opening day. Taylor Simmons, CBC News, Toronto.
I got a taste of what it's going to be like to have your classes and manage your own time and not have a teacher pushing you to do what you need to.
After the break, school's out for summer. Not that it's been in since March break. We'll talk to some students about what it's been like being out of the classroom. Plus,
well, I'm tracking a system that's going to bring thunderstorms across the GTA tonight, but there is lots in the way of sunshine in the long-range forecast. That's coming up after the break.
the Toronto Raptors will restart their season on August 1st against the LA Lakers. Now, under the league's format, they'll have 8 seeding games against their remaining regular season matchups. All of the games are being played at facilities at Walt Disney World in Florida with no fans in attendance. The NBA and its players' union say they've agreed to a rigorous health and safety protocol to help protect staff, coaches, and of course, players. Well, 4 Ontario teachers' unions are calling on the province to reconsider its plan to roll out its new Back to Basics math curriculum at the start of the school year. In a statement, ETFO, OECTA, OSSTF, and the AEFO say, quote, at a time when school boards and educators are preparing for schools to safely reopen and addressing student learning gaps, it is short-sighted to require that resources be diverted from those efforts to try to comply with an unrealistic 2-month timeline set by the government. Instead, the unions are asking for a 2-year timeline for the implementation. That statement, of course, coming out on what is technically the official last day of school. But instead of students clearing out their desks and lockers, they just shut down their computers. Schools have been empty for months due to the pandemic, with students finishing the year online. Alice Chasson spoke with some students about the experience and the lessons they say they'll take from it.
This is our school's main hall, we call it. It's always so busy, so many students. Such a lively part of our school, and it's so weird to see it so empty.
Especially on the last day, I could only imagine people would be like bursting out of their classrooms.
Yeah. Normally, when the bell rings, immediately it's flooded.
School's been weird for a while, for all grades, middle schoolers too.
I'd wake up normally around 8:50, now that I don't have to walk all the way to school, I just walk a few steps down the stairs.
Love that.
Then I just log in, go on to school, see what the teachers posted.
It took time to adjust for me, but eventually I got used to the fact, okay, my teacher's gonna have a meet, then right after he's gonna post some work, he's gonna go through all of it, then I just have to spend an hour or two and finish that work.
It was like being in a classroom, but no one knows you're there.
Do you feel like in that sense, this experience prepares you for post-secondary?
I think so, yeah. We've learned a lot of time management, self-care, and going into post-secondary, those are all very important things.
I got a taste of what it's gonna be like to have your classes and manage your own time and not have a teacher pushing you to do what you need to.
High schoolers like Ivy and Domenico were robbed of their prom, but that didn't stop Earl Hague students from showing off their prom outfits. Oh, I know that there'll be better days. Grade 8 grad was a little less glam.
They streamed it instead, so we just watched a graduation ceremony.
But Chris and Mansi can at least look forward to September, when they start high school at Earl Hague and can hopefully start making some of the same memories Domenico and Ivy had in their beloved classrooms.
Did you get a chance to say bye to teachers?
On the way in, I saw my grade 11 biology teacher. He wished me good luck in my next years. I promised to come back to visit.
I love this school so much.
Ali Chiasson, CBC News, Toronto.
Time for a check on the weather forecast with meteorologist Nick Cernkovich. So, Nick, plenty of patios open downtown tonight. How is the first full weekend of summer looking?
You know what, Mike? It's looking pretty good. Now, we've got a bit of a rainy start to the weekend, but after that, lots in the way of sunshine, not just for Sunday, but actually right through next week as well. So when we talk about our weather headlines, that's certainly in it. We got the thunderstorms for tonight, starting through the overnight period, then a bit of a mixed day through the day tomorrow. Not quite as bad as that icon makes it look, but sunshine into Sunday and actually right on as we head through the rest of the week as well. 29 degrees down in Windsor, 30 in Toronto. That's what we hit through the day today. Humidex values were in the low 30s. There's the system that we're tracking for tonight. As we move through the overnight period tonight, starting somewhere around 3 to 4 in the morning for some areas across the GTA, and as you head a little bit further toward the east end of the GTA, we're looking at closer to about 5 a.m. That's when we've got rain showers starting in the region. So this is the system that we're tracking right now, and it's going to make its way through heavy at times with the rainfall and the potential for some significant thunderstorms, especially in southwestern Ontario through the overnight period. Tomorrow, you see we've got some scattered thunderstorms in the forecast, or at least some scattered showers. And then by the time we hit Saturday night, that clears out. And into Sunday, we've got lots in the way of sunshine and some really warm weather as well. That carries us through Sunday
and Monday and Tuesday. Now, how much rain can you expect with this? I would not put a lot of stock in these numbers. Generally 10 to 20 millimeters of rain, locally heavier amounts though, depending on where you are. The potential for some severe weather down in southwestern Ontario in particular through tonight, otherwise we're looking at just scattered thunderstorms across the GTA as we move through the next 24 hours. Southwestern Ontario, winds are at 21 degrees and then 20 degrees as you head a little bit further to the east. Daytime highs tomorrow, again, up to about 29 degrees. Again, these icons making it look bad, but it's actually not that bad. It's going to be scattered. Humidex values in southwestern Ontario, 35 to 37 for tomorrow. Golden Horseshoe, 20 degrees for the day tomorrow, and then 28 degrees as we head through, or rather through the overnight, 28 degrees for tomorrow. And you've got, again, scattered thunderstorms in the forecast. Long-range forecast looks like this. 28 for tomorrow, bit of a mixed bag. Now, again, it's not going to be a washout for us tomorrow. It's a mixed bag. But then lots in the way of sunshine as we head through the next week and right into Canada Day. Temperatures around 28, 29 degrees. Humidex, 32 to 34. Mike.
All right. Thank you, Nick.
The weather is brought to you by Trane, the most reliable heating and cooling brand. We test, so it runs. It's hard to stop a train.
Might want to mark your calendars. After being closed for months, the Royal Ontario Museum is opening its doors to visitors once again.
The ROM will reopen to the public starting Saturday, July 11. Yay! With new health and safety measures in place, visitors will soon be able to reconnect with one another and the museum through art, culture, and nature in a welcoming and safe environment.
The museum's permanent collection and 40 galleries will be available to explore this summer. All visitors and staff are required to wear a mask and adhere to social distancing. Tickets must be purchased in advance, with only a limited number of people allowed in at a time. The museum will be open from Wednesdays to Sunday from 10 in the morning till 5:30 in the afternoon. Some parts of the museum will remain closed until a later date. Well, that's our newscast for tonight and for the week. A programming note to tell you about on CBC Radio this weekend. Michael Enright is hosting his final Sunday edition, Sunday morning, on CBC Radio 1. He's giving an exit interview to Matt Galloway, talking about his career and the state of the world. You can hear that, as I said, Sunday morning on CBC Radio 1. I'll see you again Monday night and again on Tuesday, but that's about it. Have a great weekend. Good night.